So here we'll start with no PPT. Is it visible to all of you? Is it visible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
It is visible now.
Is my voice is audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we'll know without ado and without delay, we'll start. And because of the session has submitted to me to take the class related to which one, that is computer forensics. So the arm and the verticals, no, when we are talking about School of Forensic Science and under the School of Forensic Science, the verticals, as far as concerned, right now we are in the arena of what, that is the digital era. So the moment we are talking about globally, it is because of your global communication network. So it is because of, you know, the PTN public telephone network, PSTN public switch telephone network. So everything, every sort of, you know, the things related to the smart device. It may be the PDA, PDA stands for what? Personal digital assistants, or it may be laptop, it may be desktop, or it may be in any of the form. It may be any of the PC. So when we are about to connect those number of your PC to internet, so the moment we are connecting, that means right now we are having 4.5 billion number of your connection so far. 4.59 billion number of your connection, that means subscriber. Subscriber, that means IP address. As you know that we have IP address, that means the connection, the unique address, the connection of a host to its corresponding network. This is exactly the address. As like, no, we are having the address of the registration number of, you know, the bike, or it may be any of the conveyance. It may be your bus, or it may be some other vehicle. Whenever we are purchasing any vehicle, so your RTO of corresponding district, or it may be your state, they are assigning and allotting the numbers. They are very unique. So once the unique number, they will be allotted to some of the vehicles, so cannot be used by some other people. And that's why, so in that way, we are also having a unique IP address. And each number of, you know, the subscriber, that means whenever we are having a telephone, that means a smartphone, and bearing some of the network, it may be the Jio, or it may be BSNL, or it may be some other network, or the ISP service provider. So that means we have to have a kind of, you know, the IP address. The moment we are connecting to the network, that means we have a subscribed and authorized the subscriber to the service provider. Now here the concern is that, as because of, no, the 4.59 billion number of, you know, the connection, more the connection, more the criminal activity, they are increasing day by day. So because, you know, from morning to night, and every time, so whenever we will see any of the people, they are taking just a handheld system. It may be the PDA, or it may be any of the device. So with the subscription of the connection, that means we are vulnerable to, because of they have connected to the network systems, which is very vulnerable, which is open to attack to anyone. And for that reason, as far as concern, we have every facility, we have every privileges. We can take every facility within a second of two, nanosecond of two times, and we can reach to any of the corner within the global. And for that reason, simultaneously, when we are taking the benefits, so behind the benefits also some form of, some different kind of, the vulnerabilities, they are also increasing. That means vulnerable, that means they are open to attack, the weakness. Now, our work, right now we are concerned about computer forensic. When we are talking about computer forensic, that means this is, as far as concerned, this is a investigation part. The investigation part, that means we are the experts, those who are taking this kind of, the course. It may be the distance learning, or it may be the digital, the direct course, or the regular mode of your course. But whatever the kind of your course, we are taking the help of, to become a expert in the field of, computer forensic. So forensic, that means what exactly? No, this is a kind of an investigation. We have to go for the investigation. In what manner? Digitally. As far as concerned, your forensic science is of two different, different number of your verticals are there. Like physics, ballistic, documentation, then fingerprints, then biometric, then chemical, then toxicology. And as far as concerned, these are the department, they are coming under what? The biology. But so we do have another part also, another umbrella, and that comes under, the computer forensic, and it is related to the digital arena. Digital, that means what? Here we are going to deal with the zeros and ones, the binary bits. See, whenever we will have some form of a crime scene related to the digital form, and let's talk about one example is that my face, my image, or my voice will be utilized in different manner. It may be in Facebook, or it may be in some different number of your medias. When my voice and my face will be utilized for some other, by the help of some masquerading people, a third party people. So in that time, so there is a chance of so we will have the kind of a crime, and it's a kind of an illegal, unethical work, who are taking my image and voice, and they are utilizing for their purpose to take the benefit of the situation. How to stop that one? So let's say that has happened, and the people who, the ill-intentioned people who has taken my photo and my voice and accomplished his or her job to do his accomplishment at that particular situation. Once the accomplishment has done, after that, how to identify the who is the exact culprit? Because my face is there, my voice is there, but that is not actual. So my voice and my face has taken for some other, and that has been utilized to take the situation and benefit of that situation. Once accomplishment has done, that means this is a kind of digital crime scene. Once the digital crime scene has happened, after that, how to recover, how to find out the expert, and belongs to those fields, and this is especially related to the computer forensic department. And under the computer forensic department, so you are the experts as far as concerned right now who have joined in this particular session. So those are the people, they have joined this computer forensic. You will be become a computer forensic to find out this kind of crime scenes and related to digital activity. We are not going to deal with the biological activity like RNA, DNA, sweat, it's a saliva, or it may be something like documentation, fingerprint, or it may be some other form. But we will deal with what? So it is related to computer. It is related to network system. There we have to protect and to safeguard these number of your things. How this can be done? And for that reason, I have made some kind of PPT to make you understand. So we will start talking about this one. So this is the session to learn computer forensic and become an investigator. How we will investigate the digital crime scene. So that will be the part. Now here, so this is the introduction. As you know that in the syllabus, as far as concern, what your OSOU, Odisha State Open University has made. Under that, we will talk about learning objectives, introduction, definition of computer forensics, cyber crime, evolution, different types. Then there you have the computer process, the modality, then need of computer forensics, rules, the legality, legacy, then computer forensics. Then what is forensic readiness, goals, benefits, disadvantages, advantages, then different form of steps for forensic readiness planning. So that will be subsequently will be discussed. Now what learning objectives? So first, as far as concerned, we'll emphasize first six number of few things. At the end of this session, you will come to learn what is digital forensic, how many types of your digital forensics there we have. Know the past and evolution of digital forensics, the history, or we may call it something like evolution. Describe various types of cybercrime. Then realize the benefits of computer forensics. Identify about forensic readiness. Then implement forensic readiness plan. So these number of few things subsequently they will be talked. Now need for computer forensic. As far as concerned, I have taken this slide from a different source. So see, basically to accomplish this kind of, to become an expert related to computer forensic and to do your job in a good manner and well-defined manner. So we have to undergo four different kind of your work activity. The first one is that to ensure the overall integrity and the control. See, before to start talking about this computer forensic, we all are tied upon one kind of your rules and regulations. Just try to remember this point. This is very much important. Before to start talking about this particular slide, those who are belongs to this particular session and to become a expert in the cyber world, or it may be a computer forensic. So you have to remember one thing, and that is a CIA triad. We all are the people, all are tied with a rule and regulation. What is that? That is exactly CIA. CIA stands for confidentiality, integrity and availability. Confidentiality, integrity and availability. So this is exactly a company. This is exactly an incorporation. CIA stands for what? Confidentiality, integrity and availability. The moment we are talking about any of the safeguarding, that means protection, how we will provide protection to the system, the computer, or it may be the network. And by far, right now we are talking about computer forensic. That means we all are tied up on the, that one part, that is the triad. It is a set of rules and regulation, and they have tied together within one organization, and that is CIA. Confidentiality, integrity, and availability. What is that exactly? That means confidentiality, that means how to provide or protect the resources of computer from unauthorized viewing. And second is that integrity. How we will protect or give safeguard to the unauthorized changes or modification. Third, availability. Availability, that means how we will give authorized access to the authorized people. When they want, they can access to that. That is availability. So these three things we have to penetrate in our brain so that we can work in a well-defined manner to become a good cyber expert, or it may be the forensic expert. So first of all, we have to undergo four different arms, as I shown in the slide. So I am taking the pointer option, just hold a second. So this is to ensure overall integrity and to continued existence of an organization, computer system and network infrastructure. As far as concerned, this is related to electronic communication media. That means whatever the thing here we will do, this is related to electronic form. This is related to electronic form. In the form of, it may be the computer, laptop, desktop, the SSD, or it may be hard disk drive, mass storage device, or it may be a RAM, or it may be ROM, where we have the memory, where we have the volatile memory, or it may be flip-flops, or it may be some other form of your registers. As far as concerned, so we are the expert, we will investigate where exactly the kind of the modification, alteration, disrupt and malfunction has done knowingly by the person. So that can be done by that can be investigated by us people. So the next is that to extract, process, interpret and factual evidence so that it proves the attacker's actions in the court of law. See, we are the experts, we are the people. Why we are taking the help of this kind of your course? Our work is to compile a documentation. So the crime scene, upon that, our work is to investigate. Once we will investigate, then at last we have to write a documentation. What exactly done? Where we had the problem? So in which way the culprit they have done and malfunctioned the kind of the resources. So we have to present that one in a well-defined manner. So efficiently track down, so that is the perpetrators from different parts of the world to protect the organization's money and valuable time. So by keeping in mind these four things, we have to go with the solution. Now next is what is exactly digital forensic as far as concerned. So this is exactly four things we have attached with this one: preservation, identification, extraction and documentation. As I said, we have to compile in a well-defined, structural, organized manner. How to do that? For that reason, it is a process and phenomena or a system of art of preservation, how we will protect and we will defend or we will provide safeguard. Identification, the determination, then extraction, then documentation of computer evidence. Which can be used by the court of law. At last, you have to present that evidence in the court of law because of See people, right now you are taking a course. This is not a joking course or kidding course. This is as far as concerned, whatever the evidence you will collect and you will compile at last, that is to present in the court of law. And for that reason, your jury, your compilation at last will cost those people in the form of your justice. So this is a commitment from your side. Whatever you will do, you have to do in a good, well-defined manner. So again, you may go with that. It is a science of finding evidence from digital media like a computer, mobile phone, server, or it may be network system, as far as concerned. It provides the forensic team with the best techniques and tools. Obviously, we are going to take the help of number of tools and techniques. Otherwise, we cannot work. So complicated digital related cases. So digital forensic helps the forensic team to analyze, inspect. So this is all part of, you know, that is inspection, analyzing, identification, preservation, or it may be some form of some investigation will be done by the process. Digital evidence residing on various types of electronic devices. Various types of, that means, as I shown here, so it may be any of the form. It may be microprocessor, the caching memory, or it may be the storage device, mass storage device. It may be any of the things where we have stored our data or the resources. Exactly, when we will talk about the resources, what is exactly resources? Resources, that means it may be your hard disk drive, any of the hard disk drive, files, folders, printers, or it may be network neighborhoods. So these are the hard disk, the resources, or we may call it as something like multimedia resources. So definition, as far as concerned, so there you have a scientist, no, who given this kind of your inspection or the kind of your investigation. According to Dr. S.V. Wolf, computer forensic is a methodical series of technique. See, you have to remember this word. So methodical series of techniques and procedures for gathering evidence from digital devices that can be presented in a court of law in a coherent and meaningful format. See, whatever the evidence upon that you are working, at last you have to present that in an intelligible form, which will be very transparent, which will be very clear and legible, where we do not have any artifacts. So in that way, you have to work. Then what are the application of this one? As far as concerned, computer forensics can be used for data recovery. Data kimti recover kari pariva. In what way we will recover the data? Data, that means, as I said, it is any of the form. It may be the text. It may be the text. It may be the audio. It may be the video. Or it may be in any of the metadata. Fine. So data recovery, log monitoring. Log monitoring, that means what exactly? So see, whenever we are doing any sort of your work, no, in the mono system, it may be your desktop, laptop, simultaneously with the network also. Each time we are doing, no, any sort of your work, behind that, no, we are leaving some sort of a footprint. We are leaving, or we are working with some sort of, you know, temporary files. Those are the files who help us to guide, and they are keeping track, monitoring our activity. So there you can find the activity of each and every people, what packet exactly they have reached inside my system and they have out from my system. So that kind of, you know, that activity you can watch, you can, you know, monitor. So that is the thing, log monitoring. Data acquisition from the retired and damaged devices, then fulfill the compliance needs. At last, you have to present in a compliance report. See, as far as concerned, classification cyber crimes. So your cyber crimes, that means digitally, that means the crimes knowingly, intentionally, whenever a person, they are deleting, abrupting, or knowingly they are corrupting or deleting the data, then we may call it as something like it's a form of your crime, but in the form of your digital. And for that reason, this is related to cyber crime. So we may have two different forms where computers are used to commit crime, and in another form where computers become target of crime. So you have two different types of your cyber crime. One is that where computers are used to commit a crime. Computer to use karke commit kariwa crime, where computers become target of crime. Je crime kariwa ko chahunchi, ko computer re mu crime kariwa ko chahunchi. So already some espionage, some hackers, they will sit together somewhere and they are committing to do a kind of a crime. And as far as concerned, so the first one under this one, where computers are used to commit a crime, threatening email, that is known as cyber stalking. Threatening email, that means, that is known as cyber stalking. Then assuming someone's identity, defamation, damaging the good reputation of someone. It may be incorporation, the company or infrastructure, or it may be by the help of spam or phishing. So this is what, in another form, viruses, worms, these are coming under where computers become target of crime. तमे virus पढ़ते कि मतलब चेष्टा करी कि निजो computer को मध्य malfunction करी परिवो you can stop the services or it may be by the help of industrial espionage, the practice of spying. Industrial espionage, that means what? They are the kind of your spy. So positive ethical spies are there. Unethical spies also are there. They are roaming in the market. Software piracy and hacking. So these are different form of the cyber crimes. So as far as concerned cyber crimes, they will available in the form of hacking. Hacking, that means what? So those are having what exactly hacking? The moment we are talking, so people they are telling hacking, that means in a negative sense. Not exactly these are negative sense. Hacking, that means those are the person who are having a skilled. Those are the person, skilled person related to the coding, related to the languages, related to their field, to enter inside with permission and without permission. They are having the skill and dexterity to crack the password. If so, they may call as hacker. We may not take the hacker in a different and negative manner. Hacker may be positive sense, hacker may be in negative sense. Those are the hacker who are ethical, they may called as white hat hacker. Those are ill, unethical, they may call it something like black hat hacker. And in between this one, white and black hat hacker, those are having less or no highs people, having inexperience, but having some sort of relative terms and terminology with the help of tools, they are just joking and trying to spy or trying to enter inside some of the system, gaining access to some unauthorized system. Then they may be called as gray hacker. So hacker, there may be three types: ethical hacker, unethical hacker, and another is the jokers. Jokers, that means they are the gray hacker, gray hat hacker. So child pornography, so whenever we are using the abuse porn photos of childs, at that time they may be called as child pornography. Then cyber stalking, as I said, whenever using some media, electronic communication media, when we are sending, threatening repeatedly using some email form or it may be WhatsApp to somebody, then this may be called as cyber stalking. Denial of service, so whenever some form of your, it may be a kind of your code or malicious code or intentionally or knowingly or unknowingly, when we are creating some form of your code and we are disseminating that to the system to stop its normal service and execution, then we may call it as something denial of service. Whenever we, let's say, talk about one application will be there, when we are about to start that application, but it is unable to start because of, due to some of the reason, some has imping, some has invoke, some kind of, the execution file, and that execution file has stopped to start working. And that is what denial of service, that is virus dissemination. So as you know that virus dissemination, that means it may be by the help of different kind of, the softwares. These are some number of, the kind of a program which will be disseminated among your systems or among through the application, through the software, so the intention is that what? To stop the service. So it will stop your normal execution, and that may be the part. Software piracy, that means some has created, let's say talk about Microsoft, they have created some form of the software, but we are taking that software and we are taking the help of that software as our own by doing some sort of customization of that software, and we are taking the help of Microsoft, but that is exactly related to Microsoft, but we are customized and we have named it as belongs to Gyanaranjan of my own software. If so, then there is a software piracy. Then there you have IRC crime. IRC, that means internet relay chat, that means it may be WhatsApp or it may be email or it may be some other form where the social media, they have the global communication, they have interconnected, everybody they have get connected. So those are the things. It may be the Facebook or it may be Instagram or it may be Pinit or it may be some other form. So whenever we are having some form of your crime over there, so it may comes under your IRC internet relay chart. Then credit card form, so there is no credit card or it may be debit card, you have your information. If you have your information while someone is taking our information and they are taking our money from my account, then we may call it something like a fraud. So net extortion, so it is all about extortion, that means what? Atyachar. So using some people will take your let's say talk about some form of your PCS data, some form of your mulyaman jinsotama managra jentike password, or it may be email, or it may be let's say talk about your company or organization something, some information, and they will extort atyachar karibe against to that kind of, you know, the evidence. So mo pakare ei jinsa ta achi mu rakhichi tame jodi na dabo mu tamu ganare iya karibi. So it's a kind of your atyachar, extortion operation. And phishing, that means what exactly? Email. So something will let's say Amazon, one email will come to your mail account, and it is from your Amazon. Because no, Amazon, why it is from Amazon? Because no, the people who are randomly and repeatedly using Amazon service, so some other masquerading people, they know that you are using Amazon. From Amazon will, you know, a kind of your, you know, email will come to your email account and will announce, so by clicking this link you will get 1 crore of rupees, because of surfing of Amazon, and you are taking most of the consignments from our Amazon. So for that reason, so we are giving you this chance to get you 1 crore of rupees, and this is a kind of a lucrative and luring the things. Once you will click on that link, then automatically you will be in trap. Your entire system will be hijacked. Your entire system, within that you have your password, you have your internet, no, like a debit card, credit card information, bank accounts, your Aadhaar card, so everything will be hijacked and will be taken by someone, so they can do anything with you, and that is what I find. So these are the forms. And as far as concern evolution of digital forensics, you can take this number of your evolution without delay, because we have allotted only 1.5 hours, so within that we have to complete 2 units. So these are the evolution of digital forensic. Hans Gross, in the year of 1847 1915, first use of scientific study to head criminal investigation. Then Federation of Bureau of Investigation, that is 1932 FBI, set up a lab to offer forensic services. See, I have taken some extra update information apart from your book, apart from your materials, so you can also go with this one, or you can also refer to your book. So as far as concerned, these are the evolution part. You can take this number of your evolution, because see, your work is to go with this 2 point. 1995, International Organization of Computer Evidence, so IOCE, was formed to work under the investigation of cyber or digital forensics. Next, there you have, in the year of 2002, Scientific Working Group on Digital Evidence, that is SWZDE, published the first book about digital forensics called Best Practices for Computer Forensics. So we are referring that book to avail those kind of, you know, the temporal relative terms and terminologies related to computer forensics. And this is what, so you can go with this evolution and history. So see, before to start talking about this, you know, kind of your forensic science, we are the people, at last we will take the help of what, the tools and technologies. Without the tools, without the technology, we cannot work. So what are the data forensic tool? So they may be called as FTK. So might be, once you will become a forensic expert, so sometime we will hear and we will use one word, and that is FTK. What is exactly FTK? FTK stands for Data Forensic Toolkit. These are the toolkit, these are the kit, these are the injection kits, or by the help of loading or installing these kit only, we are become stronger to find the investigation, the evidences in the form of, you know, to present the same in the court of law. So who are the number of, you know, the applications? The first one is that magnet forensics. So these are the some form of, so all the names has there, so you can refer to that, you can take the help of this one, but these are not open source. So these are costing like some crores. Whenever you are going to purchase these number of, you know, the techniques or the tools, this may cost you around something like 1 crore, 50 lakhs, 60 lakhs, 70 lakhs, it may in that way. So we are not going to purchase this one. So in India, one organization, that CDAR, so CDAR authorized to purchase these number, or it may be DRDO, defense organizations, so they can purchase these number of, you know, forensic, because they have availability of these number of your what, the toolkits. By the help of this toolkit, we can work with any sort of, you know, the finding the evidences in the form of, you know, it may be hard disk drive, or it may be the cartridge, or it may be some memory storage devices. But in the book, in the material, you have assigned with these number of your open source or the some form of your the tools related to the forensic, SansSift, ProDiscover Forensic, Volatility Framework, the SleuthKit, or it may be some other. So these are the data extractor. Just remember one word. These are the softwares. These are the tools. These are the injecting apps. By the help of these apps or the softwares, an expert can find out the evidences where we have exactly the manipulation, deletion, alteration, corruption that has done intentionally by a culprit. How that can be present by the help of these are some little amount of few amount of the tools I have given. But what exactly the work of this kind of few thing? So we'll talk about that one. So what are the features? See, as far as concern, in the Centurion University also, or it may be some other like GFSU, or it may be Pilani, JNTU, or it may be some other Bharatiya University, those who are big sort of big universities in the India, those they are handling this kind of the forensic department, they are taking the help of Celebrite. One tool is that Celebrite, and it is a form of UFED. What is exactly UFED? Universal Forensic Extraction Device. This is a physical analyzer. By installing this device, what a person or what expert can do? So it supports physical and advanced logical acquisition. That means we can work with the file system. File system, that means what? Anybody can participate. What do you mean by file system? Can anybody please tell me what is file system? Hello, is my voice is audible? Hello. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is Asim sir, no? Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Is it a student?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Voice is audible, sir.
So do you know what is exactly file system? Can anybody please tell me what is file system? File system মানে কোন রে পিলে ফাইল সিস্টেম মানে আমি শুনিতিবা ফেড ফাইল সিস্টেম এনটিএফএস ফাইল সিস্টেম
ইজ এ পার্ট অফ অপারেটিং সিস্টেম ওকে দ্যাট দ্য ফরম্যাট হোয়ার দ্য অপারেটিং সিস্টেম স্টোরস দ্য ভেরিয়াস ডেটা ওকে দ্যাট মে বি ফ্যাট অর এনটিএফসি জিএফএস টিএফএস এনালাইজার ফাইল সিস্টেম অফ লিনাক্স ওকে ফাইল সিস্টেমস আর देयर ফর দ্য ভেরিয়াস ডিপেন্ডিং অন দ্য অপারেটিং সিস্টেম দ্যাট ক্যান বি ডিফারেন্ট ওকে
Can I know what is JFS?
Zettabyte file system.
JFS. JFS stands for
Zettabyte file system.
Not exactly Zettabyte. This is Zonal file system.
Okay.
Zonal file system. It is belongs to what kind of your operating system?
JFS for Linux. Linux. Yeah.
Yes.
Generalized Linux. Linux 7 onwards.
Any of the
exactly.
So we are talking about that one. So so thank you for your reply. So because of that much knowledge you have, so it is all about FAT, NTFS. No, there you have file system. What is exactly file system? That means this is a something like a content, like a sticky, like something like a kind of the content, the insider. What exactly we want to put inside the system? So that kind of the index that will be maintained by the help of file system. It may be FAT32, or it may be NTFS or MTFS, JFS, Extended2, Extended3, Extended1. It may be many a kind of whenever we are using Windows under that, many a kind of your file system. Then Mac, many a kind of your file system. File system that will be a practical record use korche. While we are using the practical records, or it may be the theoretical records, initially the content. The content page, the index, the initial where you have an index page, that is exactly file system, which tracks, monitors, and stores what exactly the details things you want to go with the system. That part of your things can be given. So by the help of this Celebrite also, what other things can be done? It extracts device keys, that is the password. You can mute, sir. Once you answer, you can mute, please. So it extracts device keys required to decrypt raw disk images as well as keychain items. then decrypt. So encryption and decryption can be done also by the help of this Celebrite, right? So different imaging can also be taken. It reveals device passwords also. It allows the examiner to open the encrypted raw disk image. It supports passcode every recovery attacks. It supports advanced analysis and decoding of extracted application data. The platform provides access to physical and logical data extracted in the same user interface, making analysis easier. It reports generation in several popular manner. First of all, these Celebrite, or it may be some other kind of, you know, FTK. So these are the universal forensic extraction device. Just try to understand. These may be known as UFED. What stands for UFED? Universal Forensic Extraction Device. So these are the form of your tools and techniques to find out the investigation, to make your investigation more easier. So that may be done. Now, need of computer forensic. As far as concerned, here are the some essentialities I have mentioned. So first of all, recovery, analyze, preserve the digital materials, and the same has to present in the form of your evidence in the court of law. Then to postulate the same, the motive behind the crime career, tomar motive kon ame seta ko postulate kariya. We will present, we will we have to assume and presume those number of your know the things, and we have to go for the compliance at last, transparently or feasibly. So identity as the main culprit, then designing procedures, then recovery of deleted files and deleted partitions. It helps us to identify the evidence quickly, producing a computer forensics report, then evidence by following the chain of custody. So these are the main things. Then what are the types of cyber forensics? Kete prakar achi? See, inside that, no, there you have a circle. I have mentioned one single circle. No, this is the set. So cyber forensic belongs to three different verticals, different kind of, you know, the subsets. Like it has three different arms of your forensic department. One is related to network forensics, and another is related to system forensics, and third one is related to others. So network forensics, that means, so as far as concerned, no, we are going to provide safeguard or the protection to the system in the manner of, you know, it may be laptop, desktop, bearing some operating system and having some form of, you know, it may be the client or activity, or it may be server activity, or it may be workstation. Whenever your system, they will be connected to the network internet, at that time there you have network forensic. And apart from that also, there you have some others. Now we'll talk about network forensic. Who are the number of your forensics? They are coming under the network forensics, first of all. So they are mobile forensic. As far as mobile, that means PDA, personal digital assistances. Then malware forensics. Mobile forensics, that means inside the mobile, whenever we are keeping or taking the handheld systems, while we will have some form of, you know, the criminal activity, some has come and steal our data, some has come and they have stolen our data. So this is kind of your stealing your activity or the data from your systems. It may be from the storage, internal storage or external storage, or it may be some other form, like, you know, Google Drive, or it may be some your cloud. So a person, a third party will come and take your data. So how to find out, investigate that one. Malware forensic, that means form of your, no, it is ransomware, or it may be some like your the viruses, it may be something like trojans, or it may be something like a malicious code. So by the help of taking the codes, they will be pinged to your systems in the network systems, and your IP packet will be disrupted. IP packet, that means network will bear a IP packet. IP packet in the form of your header file, in the form of, what is that? Datagram. What is exactly datagram? That means it's a small packet. This is bearing a IP packet that contains source address, destination address, along with that the payload. Payload, that means the actual information. So malware forensic, that means whenever we are injecting or we are using knowingly, we will hit by the help of malicious code, your network system will be abrupted. Now next is email forensic. Through the email, using some .exe file, using some number of, you know, some different extension, or using some number of, you know, the lucrative kind of, you know, the images, or it may be some app or execution files. So your email can be disrupted or your entire system can be hijacked or the session can be hijacked. Next is router. Router forensic, that means it is a part of your physical device. Router, that means what? Exactly, a translator to provide communication in between two different networks. So in that also, whenever we are in a state to take your IP packet by filtration, we do have some different number of the tools and techniques. By that also, we can enter inside the router and we can also take the number of MAC address, and your MAC address can be disrupted and prodding can be disrupted. Then wireless forensics, those are the devices who are connected through without the wire. So wireless devices, so there also we are transmitting our packets, IP packets. So in between that also, it is very much vulnerable. It is open to attack. Anyone can attack your system, your handheld mobiles. It may be any of the device without the wire. Web forensic, that means it is related to which one? That is the web pages, hosting pages, or it may be something like your web pages or HTML. So in that also, we are in a state to take your So what is exactly the aim? The objective is that how we will gain access to your site. Without permission, a person can enter inside your system and take your information for their accomplishment, and that's all. So system forensic, database forensics, first of all, database forensic, that means what, as far as concerned, this is, we are going to hit your database. So some company, incorporation, multinational company, it may be the small office or home office, they are keeping the data. Let's say talk about SOHO, that is Odisha State Open University. They are dealing, or they are maintaining some number of database. They are having the database of all sort of the students. But let's say some Rajasthan people, they want to have how many number of your people they have exactly in the Odisha State Open University. If someone wants to take the information of or the the relative students information, they can enter inside the which one? That is the database of Odisha State Open University. If so, then that will be coming under database forensic. Then disk forensic, this is related to your hard disk drive, SSD storage, like a solid state drive, or it may be SSD, or it may be some other form. Memory forensic, that means your RAM and ROM, or it may be volatile, or it may be flip-flops, or it may be something like cache memory, or it may be something like level 1, level 2, level 3, different types of your memories are there. Data forensics, that means obviously data in the form of your intelligible form. So data that has derived from the metadata. So whenever we are working with the data also, the investigation and the theory and the inspection related to the data. And apart from that, others may also associate with this kind of your cyber forensic, that is proactive forensic. So deliberately, immediately, by the help of so there you have a response. Whenever we have an incident, whenever something or some form of your criminal activity or crime scene that is related to digital form that has done, so immediately how a person, a team will be respond to that one, that is the work of the proactive forensics. Enterprise forensic related to the incorporation, multinational companies, so that part, inspection. Anti-forensic, see, out of these three number of your forensic, the anti-forensic is a kind of your forensic or the kind of the knowledge. It is impossible to enter someone if someone has used the anti-forensic. That means whenever I want to enter inside the any of the system, if I have used some anti-forensic tools, then no one is going to take or no one going to investigate. Being you are an expert from this field, but you cannot get the evidence. You cannot extract the evidence if someone has used the anti-forensic tool. And this is very disaster kind of, the kind of a thing. If someone has used anti-forensic kind of your tools, so being an expert forensic, so we cannot also take the evidence using this anti-forensic tools. So next is that. So stages of computer forensic processes. So five stages: identification, preservation, analysis, documentation. Then there you have a presentation. So identification, identify the purpose of investigation, identify the resource required, data is isolated. Next is preservation, data to isolate, secure, and preserve the second stage. Then analysis, identify tool and techniques. What tools and techniques to be used? What process to be followed for the data? And in what way we are going to interpret analysis results? Documentation. So after analyzing that one using the tools and that is the techniques. So we will go for the documentation of the crime scene, along with the photograph, sketching, the crime scene mapping. Next is that presentation. So at last we have to present the same in the court of law in the form of your evidence in a transparent manner, well-defined manner. Process of summarization, explanation, descriptive manner, and you have to go for a conclusion. The conclusion has to be meaningful. It's done with the help of gathered facts. Rules of computer forensic. Now to start working with the computer forensic, what are the rules? So minimize or eliminate the chances of examining the original evidence. First of all, some number of your certain rules are there. Then don't proceed if it is beyond your knowledge. Jadi apan manang pakare knowledge kam achi jiba darkar no sethi ki jiba ta murkhami. Follow the rules and evidence jaha guideline kochi ta anusar mano. Create document. So whatever you are doing then and there, immediately you have to make a document. You have to follow the guidelines. Get the written permission, authorization for the so-and-so company who have committed a crime, or someone has committed a crime for some other. Follow the local security policy. Be ready to testify. Your actions should be repeatable. Once you have analyzed and you have your answer, you have your evidence, still you have to analyze repeatedly once after another, because you have to match that whether I know whatever the data I have got, whether that is authenticate evidence or not. You have to go for that one, and for that reason this is the step. It is very much important. Your action should be repeatable. Work first to reduce data loss. Work first jete jaldi hobo apan mane kaam karki data ku kimti data ta ku recover karibe, data ku preserve karibe, data loss ro banchebe. Don't shut down before collecting evidence. See, one thing is, no, inside the system, whenever some expert, they are trying to recover the data, once you will enter inside the system, now once you on, if the committed computer or the computer where you have the crime, cyber crime has done, the expert, when that will be opened, so you have to sit for all along the time till the end of your data recovery. Otherwise it is hard to get the, once you will off your system. So once off, that means we are losing some form of your data, the metadata, the log files, the data, or it may be the preface files. Don't shut down before collecting evidence. Don't run any program. So see, you have to stick with your own work. Whatever the work you want to go with, that part of your work you have to stick with that. Otherwise we are not going to open some other application. The application, the things what we need to extract, that part you have to stick together. Next, computer forensic team. See, this number of you thing will be done by the help of a group of forensic team. These things will be done by the help of a computer forensic team. Here are the key people that computer investigation firm should have. What are the key peoples? Investigators, photographer, incident handlers, then and there the immediate responders, then IT engineers, technicians, as you are right now. So you are taking the help of this course. Then attorney, that means at last the justice, the law, the court, and the judge. Then the first responder. What is exactly first responder? First responder, that means the first person to notify and act to the security incident. So somewhere some form of your criminal activity has done digitally, the first responder who responds the activity where we have the flaw, who have find and who have got this activity. So who will find that one? So the first person who will intimate the information regarding this kind of your, you know, to present the evidence. So that is first responder to that evidence or the evidence, that is incidents. Figure out the, understand the situation, event and problem, gather and collect the information from the crime scene, then discuss the collected information with the other team members, document each and everything. As I said, so this is what exactly from the forensic. So incident response to forensic team, it is short term and long term the distance. So how we will proceed with the events, and once we have to, you know, once we have started working with the events, the incidences, then you have to go for the isolation of your data. You have to make it containment. You have to preserve it. Then you will go for the analyzing of your data, what you have the data, then report where you have the flaw, then go for the post-incident analysis. So history, so from that also you can take where we have the alteration, corruption and deletion. From that also you can go for, this is a longer term. So short term, these are the three terms or the three number of, you know, the areas where we will work with easily. And within short span of your time, we can have the report. But this post incident analysis, we have the incidents or we have the criminal, digital criminal activity that has done right now. But we have to find out before 3 months or 4 months back, what are the incidences and where we have the alteration, who have in into the system, who have out from the system, how many times. So that part of your log also you have to find. Next. What is exactly forensic readiness? Forensic readiness is the ability of an organization. Readiness, that means the it is on behalf of organization to maximize its potential to use digital evidence, whereas minimizing the cost of investigation. So before to start working any of the organization or incorporation or multinational company, they are looking for what? Forensic readiness. In what way they can protect their organization so that if at all somewhere some problem has occurred, how fast that problem can be solved, in what way. So that measures and measures that can be presented by the help of which one, that is the organization. So goals of forensic readiness, what are the goals? Gather admissible evidences legally, ethically, without interfering with business processes, some other. To gather evidence targeting the potential crimes, disputes with other organization. To allow an investigation to proceed a cost in proportion of incident. To minimize interruption to the business from any investigation. To ensure that evidence makes a positive impact on the outcome of any legal action. So these are the goals. The readiness team, the incident response team, they have to prepare this form of your no goals once you have to. Now, what are the benefits? One, if forensic readiness will be ready by any of the organization, what are the forensic readiness? What are the benefits? So it ensures the integrity. As I said initially, it ensures the integrity of the computer system to produce evidence in the court, which can lead to the punishment of the culprit. See, this is the point. You are the expert, you are going to present this kind of your thing. So before to present the evidence in the court of law, no, so the evidence, whatever you will present, that has to be more fair way. If you have present some of the evidence without particular specific kind of your investigation, then might be a layman, a blind who have not committed that crime, but will be punished. It helps the companies to capture important information if their computer systems or networks are compromised. Efficiently tracks down the cyber criminals from anywhere in the world. Helps to protect the organization's money and valuable time. This is most important. Allows to extract, process, interpret the factual evidence. So it proves the criminal, cyber criminal actions in the court of law. So steps of forensic planning. So we know these are the 10 number of your steps as far as concern. 10 number of your steps. So first of all, define the business scenario. So as far as concern, the following 10 steps describes the key activities in forensic readiness planning. So what are the 10 steps? So first step is that define the business scenarios that require digital evidence. The problem you have to define, identify available sources, different types of potential evidence, determine the evidence collection requirement, establish a capability for securely gathering legal or legally admissible evidence to meet the requirements of different purposes, Establish a policy for a secure storage and handling potential evidence. Ensure monitoring is targeted to detect and deter major incidents. Then specify circumstances when escalation, that means intensifying due to the criminal activity, to a full formal investigation required. Train staff in incident awareness so that all those involved understand their role in the business. Digital evidence process and the legal sensitivities of evidence, 9 number. Document and evidence at last, documentation, best case, describing the incident and its impact. Ensure legal review to facilitate action in response to the incident. See, to make understand this 10 number of your steps, I have go with infography. These are the steps for forensic readiness planning. So the first step, that is the preparation. Second is gathering. Third is processing, analyzing. So first step is that preparation. That means first is the preservation, analyzing. So you have to recover, then go for the presentation of whatever you have the evidence. So your 10 steps, they have segregated, they have formed, they have placed in 4 different arms as we have started in some of the slide. So preparation, that is scenario definition. So first of all, you have to define. Then see, as far as concerned, 2 different types of, you know, depiction with the straight lines. One is the dotted line, another is that black lines. This dotted line will indicate you the business workflow, and this dotted black line, the straight black line, technical workflow. So business workflow and technical workflow, so there are 2 different work will operate simultaneously by the time of your investigation. So preparation under that one, collection, preservation, management. Then escalation of intensity, escalation, that means what? Intensifying. Whenever we will have some form of your criminal activity. So what is the, what for the intense of criminal incidents? That is the thing. Resource planning. Then under the gathering, identify, data collection, data preservation, isolation. Then continuous monitoring, digital forensic process model, then legal review. Then once this will be done with this process model, then we will go for the compilation in the form of evidence presentation at the court of law. So these 10 steps, they have formed in the infography for the easiest understanding. Fine. Now, what are the challenges we may face? The challenges, here are major challenges faced by digital forensic. The increase of PCs and extensive use of internet access, easy availability of hacking tools, lack of physical evidence makes prosecution difficult. The large amount of storage space into terabytes that makes this investigation job difficult. Any technological changes require an upgrade or change to solutions. So these are the challenges by the time of your digital forensic investigation. What are the examples of digital forensic? So first of all, intellectual property theft, the legal ethical properties, then industrial espionage. What is exactly industrial espionage? Espionage, that means some form of a spy, a third party who will secretly listen to your interaction. Let's say we have 2 company. One is that TCS, another is Wipro. A third party, let's say name is X. He or she will sit in between TCS and Wipro and will listen your private interaction between TCS and Wipro. A spy, or that spy may be employed or deployed by TCS, or it may be Wipro. In the payroll, they are taking the money as a spy to take the information from TCS or to take the information from Wipro. What are the valuable project upon which right now TCS is working? How the Wipro company will know? A spy automatically will spy to the company of TCS, enter inside the TCS company, and will take the information of that particular project and intimate to the company that this is the project upon which your company is working, TCS is working. So Wipro, from Wipro, the TCS will be intimated. Now the TCS will have the intimation, the information. So this is what industrial espionage. Employment disputes, that is between the company to company. then fraud investigations, inappropriate use of internet and email in the workplace, forgeries related to matters, bankruptcy investigations. It may be in the form of your cards, like a debit card, then it may be digitally. Whenever we are doing the transactions digitally, it may be your Paytm or MobiWeek, or it may be something like ICICI Bank, or it may be some other bank. During the time of transaction, if your bank account has gained access by some other third people or unauthorized people, then that is bankruptcy investigations. Issues concerned with the regulatory compliance. Now, what are the advantages? So these are the advantages: to ensure the integrity of the computer system, to produce evidence in the court of law, can lead to the punishment of the culprit. तम मानकर जो एविडेंस तुम जेनेट करथिबो सेही एविडेंस टा कोर्ट ऑफ लॉ रे एविडेंस हिसाब रे जिवो अ पनिशमेंट दिया हो एंड फॉर दैट रीजन यू द पीपल वेरी मच एसेंशियल इन दिस प्रोसेस इट हेल्प्स द कंपनीज टू कैप्चर इंपॉर्टेंट इंफॉर्मेशन इफ द कंप्यूटर सिस्टम्स और नेटवर्क्स आर कंप्रोमाइज्ड आपण जेतो एविडेंस दोचंती और व्हेनेवर यू आर प्रेजेंटिंग द एविडेंस फ्रॉम व्हिच सोर्स वी हैव गॉट दिस एविडेंस एट वेयर द डिलीशन और malfunction has done, in what way, so expert will intimate to the company people, so please do something in this process so that from this area no one can take your data. So fourth is that efficiently tracks down cyber criminals from anywhere in the world, helps to protect the organization's money, valuable time, allows to extract, process and interpret the factual evidence, so it proves the cyber criminal actions in the court of law. These are the advantages. So though where we have the advantages, there you have the cons, disadvantages. So major cons, drawbacks using digital forensic. Digital evidence accepted into court, however it is must be proved that there is no tampering of your data. Those are the expert, those who are involved in this process. If investigator they have employed to do so, the team, the expert, do not tamper the data. Whatever the evidence you will have, that has to be known. They have to commit with loyal and trust with the company. We are not going to tamper the data because we are not going to leave the culprits. So producing electronic records and storing them is an extremely costly affair. This is the disadvantage. Legal practitioners must have extensive computer knowledge, need to produce authentic and convincing evidence. If the tool used in the digital forensic is not according to the specified standards, then in the court of law, the evidence can be disapproved by justice. Again, repeating, if the tool used to forensic digital is not according to the specified standard, that means whatever the tools you are using, that has to be governed by some number of your standards, the policy makers, under some policy makers, then it is in the court of law, the evidence cannot be disapproved, can be disapproved by justice. Lack of technical knowledge by the investigation officer might not offer the desired result. This is also a good point. Now from unit 1 we have the summary. Computer forensics is the practice of collecting, analyzing, reporting on digital data in a way that is admissible. Computer forensics are specialized expertise that goes beyond normal data collection, preservation of techniques available to user and users of system support personnel. Third, computer crime or cyber crime is any crime that involves a computer network activity crossing the international borders and involving the interest of least one nation state is sometimes referred to as a cyber warfare. The ancient Chinese and fingerprints to identify business documents. Sir Francis Galton established the first classifying fingerprints. Then IACIS, International Association of Computer Investigates Specialists, international non-profit corporation composed of volunteer computer forensic professionals dedicated to training and certifying practitioners in the field of forensic computer science. The first FBI regional computer forensic laboratory established in the year of 2000 at San Diego. The survival and integrity of any given network infrastructure of any company or organization strongly depend on the application of computer forensics. It is true. Forensic readiness is the ability of an organization to maximize the potential to use digital evidence while minimizing the cost of an investigation. Monitoring should be targeted at specific problems. 12. Physical security of data such as backup files, data recovery, that means you have to put somewhere, backup files or central log servers is important from the data protection point of view and also for secure evidence storage. The policy for secure storage and handling of potential evidence compromises security must ensure the authenticity of the data also exists to demonstrate the evidence integrity is preserved whenever it is used, moved or combined with the new evidence. In addition to gathering evidence for the use in court, evidence sources be monitored to detect threatening incidents in a timely manner. It is too required. So suspicious it can be system generated, such as by the rule base of an IDS detection system or the keywords of a content checker, and some will be triggered by human watchfulness. So the decision as to whether to end the situation to management will depend on any indications looking to the intensification of harness, that is a major business impact is likely or dislikely, that a full investigation may be required immediately or later by the help of investigator. Necessary to ensure that staff is competent to perform any roles related to the handling and preservation of evidence. The aim of investigation is not just find a culprit or repair any damage. An investigation has to provide answers to questions and demonstrate why those answers are credible, why we will believe that one, in what manner and on what basis. At certain points during the collating of cybercrime case file, it will be necessary to review the case from legal standpoint and get legal advice on any follow-up actions. So as far as concerned, these are the shortcomings and the summary and summarization of your first unit. As far as concerned, we have covered the first unit. So till the first unit cover.
Hello. So, sir, today we conclude with unit one. In the next class, we'll discuss about the unit two, that is computer forensic investigation process.
Okay, sir.
So now I'd like to request the students and learners to ask their queries. So we'll discuss for next 10 to 15 minutes.
Do you have any query related to this? No, part of your investigation forensic. So you can ask.
Yes. So learners, please, if anybody have any kind of query, you can write on the chat box, and also you can unmute yourself and you can ask it one by one. So I have a query. I have got a question from Chittaranjan Pani. He has asked about any example of anti-forensic tools.
Yes, we do have anti-forensic tools. We do have anti-forensic tools like analyzing. A kind of a tool is name is that upstreaming. So we I am not going to announce some number of the tools because this is beyond our ethics also. While we are talking about investigator or as a learner, we are not going to name the tools name, but we do have some number of your 4 to 6 number of your tools, or you can also watch or find that one in the internet, because once I will name those number of your tools, might someone will take the benefit of in a negative way, and for that reason I'm not going to use the word or the name of the tools. But we do have some 4 to 5 number of your tools. Let's say talk about whenever we are or assume one situation. When we want to enter inside or we want to hijack one session, let's say right now we are in a session and this is a Google Meet. Someone, they are trying to enter inside, let's say third party, they want to enter inside this particular session. Then in what way? So obviously they are going to enter inside the session. we have a different way of, you know, the tools and techniques. With that we can enter, but using those tools and techniques, they only help us to enter inside that particular session. But by the help of this particular anti-forensic tool, no, if we are using anti-forensic tool, then we are not leaving any sort of, you know, the evidence by the time of your entering inside that one. The example is that VPN mastering. So instead of using our own IP address, if we are using some other's IP address, then this is a form of your anti-forensic tool. So instead of using our own original IP address, if we are using some other, let's say this is India using 194.64.68.69, and China is using, let's say, talk about this is 201.202.76.78. So if I'll masquerade, if I'll use another IP address against to my original IP address, then might be by the time of your investigation. So because of I have used some anti-forensic tool, I have given you one simplest example. This is not exactly your anti-forensic tool, but this is the way. So we are not leaving any evidence. It may be any type of, you know, the cracking, password cracking, or it may be the tools, or it may be hijacking. Okay, so that's why this is a form of, you know, simple example. Asim sir, next.
Yes sir. There is a question from Radha Mohan Acharya. How to detect the internal crimes through forensic method?
How to
detect the internal crimes through forensic method?
So it is very easy, no? So we cannot find the in immediate manner. We have to undergo 4 to 5 stages, as I shown you. So whenever simply let's say talk about one scenario is there, as I said, immediately. So when someone has done some form of, you know, any criminal activity related to digital form, let's say talk about your Facebook hijacking. Let's say someone has entered inside the Facebook, taken your, no, by the help of some of the help of your tools and techniques, they have taken your password and ID, entered inside your Facebook, and done some kind of some mal intentions or mal kind of activity to your Facebook, and post some antisocial kind of post or some form of your information which is against to the code of conduct. So immediately by the help of government of India, so that we have the investigation bureau, or it may be in some other reliable source, so whenever this will be come to notice, so immediately they will be informed. So it is some form of antisocial work, and that is done impinged within your Facebook. So when this will be done, so immediately the people who have associated within this process, no, as like right now we have corona 19 virus, so entire association will be blocked. So who's having the Facebook account, that particular accounts, and associated within that, let's say 1 to 2 months or 3 months, or it we will take 6 months of the network traffic, let's say we have 6 months of log files, entire log file for the 6 months they will be investigated. So the process will be start, investigator expert will come, and they will block, entire association, and they will find the total log files from the background to the forefront. And it is a process, as I shown you, the 4 processes you have to go and you have to find the process, and using the tools and techniques, what particular tools will be used to find this kind of your activity, that depends upon the situation, and it is a process, as I shown you, sir.
Yes, sir. So then the next question is, it is by Mr. Bhanu Pratap Sethi. Central Intelligence Agency, CIA, is how much important for computer forensics?
Yes, exactly. This is, as I said initially, how much, how much required, how much essential because of CIA. I don't want to answer much related things to related to this one. CIA, how to provide confidentiality, integrity, and availability. these three things, no, they are keeping notice all the times how to provide these three things by the process. How to protect the unauthorized viewing, how to protect the unauthorized alteration, how to provide protection against the authorized, the assessment of your data. This thing will be, these three things will be done by the help of this CIA triad. And for that reason, the company, the organization, the investigation team, always they are in touch with this number of your CIA triad. And that is why this is much important. Sir.
Yes, sir. So next question is, what is data carving?
Data carving.
Yes, C-A-R-V-I-N-G.
Data carving.
Yes, sir.
Hello. What is data carving?
Yes, sir. What is the problem?
Hello. It is not audible, sir. Please, may I have the same question?
What is data carving?
So, as far as concern, see, data carving, that means this is the word which exactly used by hackers. Data carving, like us, we are food carving. Food carving, that means, the diabetic people, those who are the patient belongs to diabetic. So they are carved. So by the time of your hungry, whenever they feel hungry, at that time, their stomach, they carve the, we have to provide appetite, they are more appetizers. So they require much food time to time. Like that, hackers also, they are data carving. Data carving, that means hackers always look for the potential data from where they can get access to the kind of, information related to which one. That is, let's say it may be credit card information, debit card information, bank transactional information. So those are the things related to which one, that is the data. They always, craze about the data related to this kind of your information. Might be somewhere I will get the password so that I can enter inside the system, or might be I can get some form of, any information of any credit card so that I can take it and I can use it and I can take 70,000 within then and there. So those are the people always looks for the data and the information in the traffic by sitting as a espionage or the eavesdropper. Then they may be called as a data carving or the data carver. Sir.
Panigrahi, can I just intervene for a minute?
Sir, yeah, please.
I am Srikant Mahapatra. I am the Vice Chancellor of Orissa State Open University.
Sir, namaste.
Namaste. I welcome you for this wonderful talk. Now, I want to tell you that I had a meeting with the Director General of Police in Orissa, Mr. Abhay. And he was telling me that the police, senior police officers at the level of SI and above, they need to be trained in forensics, cyber forensics.
Okay, sir.
So we have a course on cyber forensics in our MSc cyber security. But what I intend to tell you is that we would like to offer a 4-credit course on cyber security totally in the online platform. So we need your help. Can we develop, because we have the content, you can see the content, you can modify the content if you like, but we need a lot of videos for this on each and every aspect. What you are discussing with the students will become part of the videos, very small videos. Maybe in each unit we'll have 2-3 videos to explain the intricacies of cyber forensics. Will you be in a position to help us out?
Yes, sir. I will be there. This is my privilege to do and give you some kind of, because of I am already associated with since 2016. I am a counselor and editor of cyber.
Okay, great. So, Asim, please be in touch with him and prepare a timeline and prepare a schedule and let me know. Thank you very much. Please,
thank you for your appreciation, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Anyone?
Okay, sir. So the next question is, as all investigation has legal implications, So which IP Act is applicable in India? Hello, is it audible, sir?
This is not. This is related to the guidelines.
Cyber law.
The guidelines and the intellectual property rights. I'm not going to name it because I do not have the idea, because we have to remember many number of, you know, IT acts. So it is particular things related to the particular kind of your acts. If I'll answer right now, so we do have number of your IT acts. So this is the work of the cyberspace or the cyber law. Those who are talking about that part, so they can answer.
Okay, so I would like to add here something. As all of you know, there is a IT Act 2000, that is what our India government is using, and it has been amended in 2008. So I think 2008 is the latest act, and there are lots of different sections that deals with this IT related things. And for digital forensic or cyber forensic, there is a particular section. And tomorrow we have a class on cyber law and regulation. So in that class, we can discuss all about it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, next question is how to monitor log file of a system. I think we will discuss it later in other unit.
Log file can be, so see, again, people know, I am just, whenever we are the experts or we are the teachers related to forensic department, we are giving you knowledge. When we are telling, this is a part of your, kind of your knowledge to share. And whenever I will name it, so might be you will take the benefit of that in a negative manner. And for that reason, I am naming only one name. There we have a upstreamer. There we have a tool named, and that will be used in the XP and Vista. So in the Windows system, with the help of your command prompt or with the help of your Linux also, we can watch the log files. Or very simple, there you have a prefetch file. So just go to Windows plus R, run command, type there prefetch, prefetch. From there also, normal, this is the easiest way. This is very open. One body can each see and watch this kind of the prefetch file.
Okay, so the next one is related to hacking. How we know our mobile is being hacked?
So how your mobile is being hacked, how can you know that? So for that, exactly. So see, we have the rootkit. Can I, Asim sir, can I out from this screen?
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Just hold a second.
Stops on you. Okay. Can play the ops sharing.
Okay, done.
No. Yes.
Pop screen sharing. Done, sir.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Now you have asked me, how, in what way someone will know that your computer or it may be your laptop or it may be desktop that has hacked. So it is very simplest way. So you have to have the registry knowledge, or without the registry and your that is the rootkit knowledge. No one going to know about this form of the system of your hacking. So there you have a formality of registry key. Let's say assume 64 number of your registry will be entertained. Out of the 64, whenever this will be increased from 64 to 65, 67, 68, at that time we will come to know that something, some malfunction has been done with our registry. Registry, that means what exactly? These are the some form of a kind of your form of your arrangement or a organized arrangement. Like your registry key inside your system, there you have regedit. In that also we have four different arms. In the system or in the phone also, there you have registry key that is known as rootkit. So you have to enter inside that rootkit and you have to keep track and you have to have the knowledge related to rootkit. Otherwise you cannot answer. Sir.
Yes, sir. And the last question that we have received from Prabhat Panda is, are there any forensic lab equipped with the tools for such investigation?
Yes.
Since costly, which are available to avail service by investigator?
No. Right now we do have that one in our investigator team. Achyut sir handling that one in the Odisha also. You can watch in roadside, that is Rasulgarh. So there you have Achyut sir, and we can also find this one in IIIT Bhubaneswar. From CDAR, 40 crores of your project has been installed over there. And as far as concern, also I am a cyber consultant and handling as a member of Centurion University. There also I am handling this part of the Celebrite FTK toolkit. So there also you have a 40 crores of the experiment hand hands-on practice will be get over there. Sir.
Yes, sir. So these are the questions that we have received in our chat box. And if any student have any kind of question, then they can unmute their mic and ask the question that. Yes, please. Yes, anybody? If anybody have any doubt or question regarding this unit yes, one sir, of cyber forensic.
Hello, I'm Prabhat Pandan.
Yes, sir.
Please ask.
I'd like to know, you mentioned about something specified standards of tools to be acknowledged in the court of law. Is there any real, what are those specifications?
Yes, exactly. We do have some guidelines, that has been defined by the CIA triad. As I said, initially I have mentioned CIA triad is an incorporation like your IEEE.
Is it something like that? ISO, IS, BIS, exactly. Those kind of things?
Exactly, sir. Something like ISO, or it may be OSI, ISO, something like International Standard Organization or International Organization for Standardization. In the same fashion, also, we have some other company. And as far as I'm concerned, when we are in a state to work with cybersecurity and digital forensic, like CIA triad, then there you have NIST, then there you have ESCI, then many companies are there, many incorporations are there. They are defining the guidelines. Whenever we are having a bike, let's say talk about, we are going to purchase a Polo car, Volkswagen. So that car, when that will be unveiled and that will come to the market, it has to go undergo some number of guidelines. And that guidelines has been defined by the motor companies. So that is looking to the what safety securities has been installed in the car. So number of your things that has to match 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 according to that, the rating will be defined. In the same fashion also, while we are using the tools and techniques in the forensic also, so you are getting the same things.
Okay, thank you.
Anything?
Yes, welcome. Anybody else?
So one more thing. The digital the forensic investigators, when they submit the reports after investigation, do they also have a role to recommend to any practices to be modified in the organization, which will prevent any future such cyber crimes?
Yes, sir. Exactly. By the time of it's a parallel process, sir. So you have asked a good question. So I really do appreciate this kind of a question. I will happy to handle this kind of a question. See, parallelly, as far as concern, while we are become an expert or investigator expert, so your study, your material will give you the kind of a knowledge. While we are presenting the evidence, simultaneously, we have to present how to fix that one. In what way the weakness, the vulnerability, at where the alteration, the modification, the deletion, the abrupt, and that has done knowingly or unknowingly, how to fix that one, what way that can be fixed, so that can also be done. And we have to go with that parallelly, and we have to intimate to the, it may be a court of law or simultaneously with the investigator experts, so that the company can fix that one. So the procedure also can be in the wind of your location.
Okay.
Anything?
Thanks a lot.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Panda. Anybody? Otherwise, yes.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes. Yes. Yes, Sagarika, madam, please.
Yes, sir. I am just following Mr. Prabhat Panda's question. So, is always we have to dependent upon a crime and then only we will fix that problem, or we are thinking about the future thing. But can we, before the crime, we can take some steps in the terms of forensics? so that that can be resolved priorly.
Yes. For that reason, no. Always, whenever we are having some kind of your investigation, this is not at all related to investigation. It's a process, pre and post, before the incidents, after the incidents. We do have two different types of your investigation. This is not only the part of your investigation. Before the investigation also, every company have their own sort of your portfolio. That portfolio, that means while we are running our organization, always they have to go with some kind of firewalls, the safeguarding of their organization precious the information. So once the incidents has done, so before the incidents and after the incidents, we have to watch the entire process. In what way we will go with that one, and for that reason we have to analyze ourselves, and for that also we have a study. Before the incidents we have a sort of your study, and after the incidents we have a process, and with the process also subsequently we will be in touch with this kind of your course, and you will come to understand what exactly the kind of your things to be done. Anything
thank
else?
Thank you sir.
Yes sir. Mr. Pradyumna BC, I think you have something to ask.
सर ये फ्री रे किसी अच्छी की मतलब साइबर फोरेंसिक ऐप
हां अच्छी बट जेमते मु कहली ना तुम मन को एटा हमें माने कोर्ट ऑफ लॉ रे एविडेंस प्रपोज माने प्रपोज करी परिवानी सेटा को यूज करके बट हम मन कर जो ओपन सोर्स ओडिसा स्टेट ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी रे जोटा मेंशन हे छु मु देखे छी जो टूलोडा से टूलोडा रे तुम मन कर ओपन सोर्स किछ अवेलेबल अछि मु देख छी
PPT. Yes, I would like to add two things here. Yes.
Welcome.
Just install the Kali Linux, you may get lots of different forensic tools over there. Those are freely available. So if you install Kali Linux in your system, and then you can access few tools over there, like AutoSpy and all those are available. And if you want to go for any kind of practice, then you can go for the few trial version of software there. 30 days trial or 7 days trial. In our lab manual, if you follow the lab manual, you may get to list of few tools that can be used for cyber forensics. Yes, anybody else?
So we'll wind up now, sir.
Yes, sir. So thank you, Gyana sir, for your informative session and for your time.
Hello.
Yes.
हेलो सर हैंड्स ऑन ट्रेनिंग पे कौनसी बंदोबस्त अछि सर ओसु तरफ रु
यू कैन आस्क टू ओएसओ यू
आई मायसेल्फ देवदत्त बोलता सर वन ऑफ द स्टूडेंट सर
यस एवर सिचुएशन तो अपन को हैंड्स ऑन ट्रेनिंग पे लैब दरकार फिजिकली फेस टू फेस ट्रेनिंग ही दरकार बिकॉज़ ए लिमिटेड टाइम 1 आवर और 1 एंड हाफ एन आवर भीतर प्रैक्टिकली शो करके आप मानको देखेबा पॉसिबल होबनी बट यस गो थ्रू द व्हाटएवर लैब मैनुअल इज अवेलेबल फॉर यू इन कंप्यूटर फॉरेंसिक डिटेल प्रोसेस हैज बीन रिटन देयर प्लीज फॉलो द लैब मैनुअल यू कैन डू इट योरसेल्फ इवन अदर लिंक्स फॉर द सॉफ्टवेयर आर अवेलेबल ओवर देयर
असिन सर कैन आई अनाउंस समथिंग
यस यस प्लीज
So those are the learners of today's class, no 24 people who have the participant today's class. I do have one announcement, no? Today's in Eastern Odisha, your Centurion University already opened this kind of your course. And this is regarding, no?
Sir.
No, but we have the hands-on practice and MSc Cybersecurity and Digital Forensic course already opened in the cyber, Eastern Odisha. It is in Centurion University. If you want to interest or you or it may be some other also, they can join in the regular course. Thank you,
sir.
Asim, sir.
Yes, anybody else? Otherwise, we'll wind up this session for today.
Hello.
Please. Radha Mohan Acharya. Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I have put the questions in the text area. Please answer that one.
Yeah, please ask. You can ask him directly.
Actually, sir, I want to ask that what are the current and future challenges for a smartphone forensics?
Your voice is not totally audible. please make it loud.
Sir, please say about the challenges to smartphone forensics.
So in the very next class, no, we will go for that one. No, so we have much more of your things to be discussed. Okay, so this is not at all within 1 10-second we are going to face the challenges. So once we will complete, automatically you will come to know what are the challenges related to three of the verticals. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Then thank you. First, I would like to thank the learners for their participation, and finally Gyanaranjan Panigrahi for his valuable time. He keep our request and give his time for our learners and for all. It is really informative for all of us. So I would like to request here the learners, so please go through the unit 2 of cyber forensic. In the next class we'll discuss about the investigation process, so please go through it, so it will be easy for the resource person as well as you to, for him to describe the process and for you to understand. So thank you all.
Thank you so much. Have a good day. Stay home, stay home, stay alive.
Yeah, thank you all.
Sir, stop kar devi.
Yes, sir.